My name is Audun Stubhaug. I'm an anesthesiologist. I've been working with anesthesiology, intensive care medicine, and also pain medicine for several years. But during the last 7 years, I've concentrated 100% on pain medicine. And we have a department of pain management and research in Oslo. The topic here is an upcoming, very hot topic. And that's the reason I want to say a few words here about this topic. I will talk a little bit about preoperative opioid use, and I'll talk a little bit about opioid-induced hyperalgesia. And the critical role of timing was meant to be a very hot, have some hot results there, but I was not allowed to present them yet. So I will just kind of have it in say, I will say a little bit about it without presenting real results. The back curtain for this talk, we must remember, is the opioid epidemic of the United States. This is a Week magazine 10, 15 years ago. There's no excuse for pain. Doctors have the means at hand to relieve suffering. Why aren't they doing it? It was a call for the use of opioids. And it was a liberal use was promoted. And now the news, the time, first page is quite opposite. Now these drugs are the powerful painkillers, and they have created the worst addiction crisis in America. And the numbers are quite impressive. You can see the opioid admissions, the opioid sale, and the opioid deaths are increasing in parallel. From very rapidly, as you see, from year 2000 to 2010 here. I don't know if you know any of these guys. Would you buy a used car from any of them? Well, I'm not sure, but these guys had this company, Perioperative Pharma, had agreed to pay $600 million in fines for illegal marketing of opioids for chronic use. And these three executives here together had a private fine of $34 million fine, these three privately. So that says something about their income, I think. So this has been a big issue in the United States, and we have some of it in, some of the waves have reached Europe as well. So what we have been very interested in earlier has been predictors of acute postoperative pain, and we have concentrated on preoperative pain, expected pain, surgical fear, and pain catastrophizing. But the hot topic now is really the opioid use. Preoperative opioid use is a hot predictor of poor postoperative pain trajectories and long-term pain. It has been shown a number of articles are coming now these days from different surgical procedures. One guy who has been very interested in the trajectory of postoperative pain is Richard Chapman, and he has been interested in this in order to individualize treatment postoperatively. While pain in the general population, postoperative population decreases slowly, it decreases rapidly in others, stays constantly in others, but there is a small subgroup where pain increases and may lead to prolonged medication. And he has shown that also that those who are opioid users before surgery have a completely, as a group, a completely different trajectory with a much higher pain report both at rest and in movement. And you as you understand, this will of course lead to higher opioid use. It will lead to less poorer function, longer stay. What are the reasons for this? Was Jørn Lutch is one of the speakers in Copenhagen, and there are some very interesting results coming up that prolonged opioid use might lead to DNA methylation, and that can explain clinical pain. So what he did show here is that, for example, in the gene coding for the opioid receptor, the OPRM1 receptor, at different locations, those who are opioid users have a much higher methylation, and this affects transcription. And what he did show was that in the opioid treated, the methylation grade predicts their pain. While in pain patients that are not on opioids, this methylation does not correlate with the pain level. So something happens with the at the gene level that affects efficacy of opioids and pain report. Now, this slide is to show that there are differences between surgeries. You show that we have procedure-specific guidelines at the Prospect website. Here's one reason why that might be smart. As you see, here are two surgical populations. We have in red breast cancer surgery, and in blue total knee replacement. And you see that the total knee replacement patients all have pain before surgery. 84% have pain before surgery, and still 50% have pain after surgery. And this is that means this is a population completely different from the breast cancer surgery patients, where nobody has pain before surgery, if they have not had a biopsy or something. And fewer patients have pain after surgery, but if they have pain, that tends to be neuropathic in their characteristics. And that's why, and this will probably Stefan talk more about later. So that means what this knee arthroplasty patients are more likely to use opioids before surgery, and they are more likely to have a difficult trajectory. I'll also draw some attention to individual variation. Stefan talked about procedure-specific guidelines. I would also like you to say that I think we should adapt the treatment individually, very individually. And I like to use this Kaelet publication to show this, because this is a study of laparoscopic cholecystectomy, and all patients had the same treatment. And you see here that each patient is a dot. Usually we present data as a mean with a standard deviation or as a 95% confidence level, and it looks like everybody is here. But here you see in the real world, some patients have no pain, others have maximum pain. And some patients still have maximum pain several days later. While you see the median is reduced, some subjects still suffer high pain. This is a publication data from Leif Arne Rostland sitting here. He was first author of several studies of on the analgesic effect of intra-articular opioids. And in order to do that study well, we were allowed by the ethical committee to not to give any analgesics. During surgery, they had either sevoflurane only, or in one of the studies, remifentanil. No paracetamol, no local anesthetics, nothing. And then we waited in the postoperative unit to see what if they developed pain, mild pain, moderate pain, or severe pain. And if they had this red, moderate pain or severe pain, we included them in a study. Now, what did we find? Well, what we did find was that 71, one third, never needed analgesia. One third. That's a national history of minor knee surgery. While some, 36, 39 of 200, had severe pain. So this underscores the huge individual variation. And that means that we will never have one golden bullet that fits everybody. That's what the surgeon asked me for. Can't you just make write up the doses so it fits everybody, and that doesn't exist, especially not with opioids. Now, second point I will draw attention to is the plasticity. Around the surgical wound, hyperalgesia appears, and that's much like many of you have experienced when you get a sunburn. When you go out in the sun, touch is not painful at all. After 4 hours in the sun in the spring for a Norwegian or a Swede, touch suddenly is painful. So a non-painful stimulus has turned to be painful. That happens after all kinds of surgeries as well. And one study who underscores this very nicely, I think, is a smart study from Korea. It compares the first and second knee arthroplasty. They did it in series, so all subjects had two knee arthroplasties with 1 week in between, 1 week only. And what happened? First, just to show that the pain they had at rest and at the flexion before the first knee operation and the second was similar. So the pain was similar before the operation. But still, after the operation, pain during flexion was significantly higher after the second. And look at the fentanyl consumption. The fentanyl consumption was doubled or tripled after 1 week. So that means those who have reoperation, those who have repeat surgery, are at risk for a different trajectory. So is opioid treatment a risk sport? One nice animal study gives us a clue, and is this study I will explain now. First, in the upper left panel here. Here we have opioid treatment only, and this can show that the withdrawal latency increases with opioids. So that means the animals withdraw their foot later after opioids treatment. That means opioid works. And if you look here, it's 7 seconds. 7 seconds on this second panel is here. And this shows something different. Here we have three groups. One group has received morphine for 7 days. One group has received morphine for 14 days pre-op, and one has received placebo. And then they all have a poor incision and operation. And we see that the latency goes down. They get hyperalgesia. And those who have had placebo, they restore their normal threshold after some days, but those who have received preoperative opioids keep being hyperalgesic for several weeks. So this is a very interesting mechanism that is now being studied also in humans. So what can we do about this? One thing we could do is to gradually, it might have to do with the choice of opioid and the way we give it. Some people in my lab has looked at what happened if you abruptly stop remifentanil. Is that bad? And in fact, they did show in this study that if we gradually reduce it like this is the effect site concentration, and we test the subjects before the infusion of remifentanil, during, and then after there should be no remifentanil in the effect site. And the results are like this. The placebo day, it's a double-blind study, placebo day, and small changes. Opioid works during the infusions. Their pain are lower, and if we abruptly stop the remifentanil infusion, pain is higher for quite a long time after infusion. While if you gradually reduce it, It's not like that. And that means that probably different opioids with different pharmacokinetics could differently affect opioid hyperalgesia, induced hyperalgesia. Another way to look at it is to give co-analgesics, as mentioned by Stefan. And this has been done also in our lab where we have a painful, continuously painful stimulus as the SMELTS model of electrical stimulation subcutaneously. And the pain in the placebo group, you can see, stays painful, slightly adaptation during, this is 150 minutes, the time line here, 150 minutes. During infusion of remifentanil, we see that the pain is reduced. And when we stop it, pain goes back and is significantly higher than with placebo. And we can see that in this case, paracoxib can prevent that, while ketorolac does not. We don't really understand this yet, but this is quite interesting. And other groups have found that, as Stefan mentioned, pregabalin, ketamine, and several other drugs, alpha-2 agonists, also prevents this hyperalgesia. So that's one thing we can do. The last very hot thing we can do is to take better care of our patients while they are in hospital. We can pick out the risk subjects post-operatively, and we can follow them better. And one of the groups that has done that in Scandinavia is the Helsinki group. They have a post-operative, they call it acute pain service. An outpatient clinic, and that means they take the risk subject, those who are on high doses during the hospital, and they follow the map. And you see here that very many of those who are considered risk patients are on opioids, and at the end of their follow-up, they have managed to reduce the opioid usage quite a lot. Another group who's leading and who's represented in Copenhagen now on this Congress is the Toronto group with Joel Katz and Hans Clark. And if you're interested in this kind of work with the so-called transitional pain service, you should read their publications. They have not yet any randomized trials, but they have good cohort studies showing that the trajectory is better in those who get quite simple follow-up. So, what do we know about perioperative opioids? It's strange that opioids are old drugs, but still, it seems that we don't. It's a lot of things we don't know. So I will end with the showing as a quote from Voltaire. I've translated it to English, of course, and I think he was right already, and still has right. This quote is from the 18th century. Doctors push drugs of which they know little for diseases of which they know less into patients of whom they know nothing. And maybe not all true, but I think we have a lot to learn even about opioids. Thank you.